good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being here tonight. We are delighted to see each and every one of you attend this event. I'd like to start tonight by saying a huge thank you to Carol Brown. I know you're watching tonight. Thank you for your generosity. You make tonight possible. Thank you also to the Irving Brown Lecture Series, the Young America's Foundation, of course, and the William F. Buckley Program hosting this event. Aren't we all excited to be here? I'm Liz Wheeler. I am honored and delighted to open the show tonight. Before I walked out here, security actually asked me if I was comfortable doing this show, given how there were some violent protesters who protested a conservative speaker a couple weeks ago. And I told them, of course, I'm comfortable just as long as Will Smith isn't in the audience. And by the way, to any leftists who are attending tonight, before you, thank you for being here. Thank you for being here. Before you try to cancel us for cultural appropriation, let me just tell you, it is not a Halloween costume. This is actually how Michael Knowles looks every day. I've heard that Rachel Maddow, Michael Knowles, who's to say? I'm told that this is actually a warm day here in New England, but compared to the senator's home state of Texas, this is quite chilly. In fact, backstage I saw him scrolling on his iPhone looking for tickets to Cancun. Like I said, I am delighted to be here. My husband, however, who is backstage, is not delighted to be here because he applied for grad school at Yale many moons ago, and he was rejected. So I like to tell him the joke's on Yale because he served in the United States Navy and, served in... served and sacrificed to protect our right to free speech. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is why we are here tonight, why this podcast is here tonight. Because a discussion about the merits of free speech triggered protesters, law students, believe it or not, triggered protesters in a way that is not befitting of the Ivy League. And we should ask ourselves, why did a discussion about the merits of free speech trigger the left? Why is this triggering to the left? And the answer is as follows. First of all, the left is generally intolerant of any views that oppose their own. They are also generally insecure about a discussion, any discussion that contradicts their viewpoint. They, well, tend to be intellectually fragile. But, and most importantly of all, it is a tactic of intimidation. It is intended to stop conservatives from speaking out, to cause conservatives not to want to set foot on a leftist Ivy League campus. And by the way, the Yale administration did not support the conservative speaker. They said they would talk to. They'd sit down and have a discussion with the protesters. And of course, you know, the Yale admin, they're not afraid of angering alums who might be in favor of free speech because, you know, who needs alum money when you are underwritten by the Chinese communists? My friends, we are here tonight in the belly of the beast. We will not be cowed. We will not be afraid. Free speech, in fact, is not just a topic worth discussing. Free speech is actually worth $2.9 billion to some rich people who build rockets. This is a serious topic of discussion. This is a necessary topic of discussion. It's why the Verdict with Ted Cruz podcast has been so enormously successful, because they are unafraid to talk about topics that the mainstream media won't discuss, that big tech censors and silences, and that corrupt politicians would rather you don't know about. It's why on the spinoff series, The Cloakroom on Verdict Plus that I host with Senator Cruz, we talk about topics related to free speech and how government is assaulting our freedom of speech, whether that is through government-controlled cryptocurrency, whether that is related to statutes on the book and Supreme Court precedent about libel and slander and defamation. You know, I'm talking about New York Times and Sarah Palin. We are here tonight to have the conversations that no one else is willing to have. And therefore, without further ado, it is my honor and my pleasure to present to you Verdict with Ted Cruz.
Things have gotten so bad that even the media are beginning to ask questions.
Something occurs to me sitting here seeing all these people, hundreds of people here. Just think about YAF. Think about the growth of the Young Americas Foundation. I mean, it's just unbelievable. Think about all the people in this room, all the campuses that YAF is on. We are here with everyone. We're going to be taking your questions. And I want to thank all of you for being here. Senator, you must be so happy. You have just left a place. There's chaos in the House. The whole city looks like Baghdad at this point. Somehow Washington, D.C. seems even crazier.
The lunatics are running the asylum.
Okay, you gave the Taliban a list of Americans. You gave them a kill list. They screwed up the evacuation.
They have made every classic blunder. This mandate is completely bogus.
That's a technical legal term.
The other topic is this infrastructure bill.
Joe Biden and Pelosi and Schumer want to spend a crap ton of money.
So you're saying the big companies like the mandate.
They love it.
And we're very pleased to be joined by Sohrab Ahmari,
Mark Meadows,
Governor Scott Walker,
Chad Wolf,
Betsy DeVos,
Attorneys General,
right.
Honey's Badger.
And I gotta say, you have been the honey badger.
Thank you.
Have you ever heard a swamp creature apologize?
I'm not holding my breath.
It does seem to be a lot of actors are interested in politics and politicians are interested in acting.
We've got to win the battle of the day and the war going ahead. You've got to win the war for the heart and soul to save this republic.
The only formal difference that I see between Dr. Fauci and the Pope, Dr. Fauci has much more power.
Everything in life has consequences. We have to be wise as serpents and innocent as doves.
There are unintended consequences. People keep fiddling with the mask and they keep touching their face.
Being a conservative requires that you recognize reality and accept the permanent things about life.
Could we do Verdict from the Senate floor?
President Biden have presided over the worst foreign policy catastrophe in a generation.
And the idea that you must wear a mask forever is idiotic.
We're only a couple of reporters who dared take their mask off. They were almost like, you know, Mel Gibson and Braveheart or something.
Does voter fraud exist?
I don't know for certain.
Why then is Twitter right now putting warnings on voter fraud?
We're simply linking to a broader conversation.
And you're a publisher when you're doing that.
Where do we go from here?
We go towards truth and light and freedom. The fundamental liberties of humanity, it is right and true and just. Our ideas work. Freedom works. Free markets work.
We're in a moment where we will go through some darkness, but the answer to darkness is always light.
We've got to go here at CPAC.
And I think we only have so much more to look forward to. Thank you all so very much. This is Verdict with Ted Cruz.
Because a week ago, there was a campaign from a liberal student in the Yale Daily News. Maybe you saw it, I don't know. There was a campaign to convince people in the Yale community not to come to this event. Because you see, to come to this event tonight would legitimize Cruz and Knowles. It would pose a threat to American democracy. And Senator, Here we are in a room full of at least 500 people, completely packed, live from Yale University. This is Verdict with Ted Cruz. Still seems to be standing, at least relatively as well as it already was.
Democracy is alive and well, the Constitution is alive and well, and despite the efforts of some, free speech is alive and well.
This is great news, especially here at Yale, because I tell you, I love Yale. This is my alma mater. I love Yale. I don't know if my alma mater loves me quite so much, but I love it. And I'm so dismayed when I see Yale at the forefront of shutting down speech. Just last week, Kristen Wagoner, a conservative lawyer, was shouted down at Yale Law School. This is supposed to be the number one law school in America. Someone actually said in the room, a Yale law student, "I'll fight you, B-I-T-C-H. That's the kind of discourse we're seeing here. I remember some years ago, there was a gal, we called her Shrieking Girl, an undergraduate screaming at her professor, saying, "This is not an intellectual space. This is supposed to be a place of comfort and home for me." Senator, what's going on in the Ivy League?
Well, Michael, I'm very glad to see that they're teaching spelling at Yale. And I will say, you know, it's you have been longing to come back here for the 2.5 years we've been doing this podcast. We went on the road. We did a campus tour last year. And I have to say, I still remember we were at Catholic University in Washington, D.C. And afterwards, a student comes up and asks you, Michael, to cite and to recite, rather, Dante's Inferno in the original Italian.
This is true. This
the is two of you proceeded to do so almost in three-part harmony. And so my question is, number one, can you do it again? And number two, what are the students at Yale going to ask you today?
Senator, when I was an undergraduate here and I was a single man, I had to learn
That's
Dante.
Hard to believe.
No, I had to learn some Italian poetry. Because, look, I wasn't on the football team, okay? I didn't have my... It was the best I could
Wait,
do.
Wait, Yale has a football team?
There's a rumor.
All right, I had to get something in.
The football team, guys, they're the only conservatives at the whole school. So,
all right, fair enough.
But the question is a really good one, Senator, which is, okay, if you're a Catholic U, they have you recite Dante. What do they have you recite at Yale? And I fear the answer is... I don't know, Foucault, Ibram Kendi these days, I don't know, Robin DiAngelo. It's the state of American higher education, though we're all having fun here together tonight, no one has busted down the door yet and yelled any 4- and 5-letter words at us, the state of American higher education.
Okay, it's only here that profanities are 5-letter words.
Well, no, the one they yelled at
like
Kristen Wagoner.
Ours goes to 11? Is it that we just put extra ones?
Yeah, some in French, you know. But the state of American higher education is in a sorry state. So what happened? We're supposed to be with the elites. We're supposed to be with the future leaders. Everyone who matriculates at Yale is told you're going to be president for 3 terms. You're the greatest person in the world. And yet, why are our elites doing such a poor job of things?
Look, higher education has embraced the idea that the school is about not challenging you, is about making you comfortable. The whole point of a university is to make you uncomfortable. The whole point of a university is to challenge you with ideas, posit as a crazy idea, that when you enter college at 18, every idea you believe maybe is not fully formed and you don't entirely understand the entirety of the universe. If that's true, the most important value of college is encountering others who challenge your ideas, who challenge your assumptions, who make you think. And look, I mean, when I went to school, I had a lot of professors who I disagreed with profoundly. I thought it was very useful to hear their worldview, hear what they're saying, because at the end of the day, most of the stuff you learn in college, you're not going to do for your career. I mean, most of the, you know, think how many classes you had in college that are useful to being a world-class podcaster.
Stop
now.
Stop it. Get out of here. You're going to make me blush.
You know, I did take bartending at Princeton. That has been useful. Mm-hmm.
That's a hard skill.
But look, at the end of the day, what you're learning is how to think. And if you're only encountering ideas you agree with, then by definition, you're not learning how to think. That's the most pernicious part of it at all is that training people in groupthink, training people you cannot think differently. You know, Galileo was told the same thing. It didn't work out well. Science, philosophy, literature, they're all about challenging assumptions, challenging what you think. And the very dynamic that you have, and look, what happened to Yale Law School, what's sad about that is it's not unusual.
Yeah.
You see it happening at universities all over the country where speakers come in. I mean, in that instance, Kristen Wagner, who was there, is a Supreme Court advocate who had just won a case by a vote of 7-2 at the U.S. Supreme Court. Now, I get it. The students at Yale Law School, they didn't like that case. They didn't like that case. They were upset about it. So instead of coming in and saying, well, you know what? I think the justices got it wrong. You know what? I think the Constitution says something different. Instead of doing what one would imagine Yale lawyers would be capable of doing, which is presenting arguments and reasoning, they instead try to exercise the heckler's veto and just scream down anyone who disagrees. That's not just harmful on the particular issue that they're not hearing the other side. It's harmful for thinking in life. And I got to tell you, when you come out of school, most places you work are not safe spaces. Most bosses are not going to be overly worried about injuring your fragile feelings. And so I think the point of education is to prepare you for life. And that means encountering things that make you uncomfortable, that make you doubt, that make you question. That's really what an education's all about.
I joked when your former, not classmate, but fellow Harvard Law graduate, Judge Ketanji Jackson, when she failed to answer the question, what is a woman? When she laughed, she said, can I answer? Of course I can't answer that question. I'm not a biologist. When she did that, my first thought was, only someone with 2 degrees from Harvard could be so stupid as to not know what a woman is. And so, I don't know, I mean, as you say, there are these problems at all of the universities, but to me, it actually seems more pronounced in the Ivy League, these supposedly prestigious institutions, where it seems that whatever you see about free speech on other campuses, Yale Law School is supposed to be the top law school in the country, screaming profanities at a lawyer for having an open discussion. How do you fix that? I don't want to sound like the old man back in my day, things were better, but things really do seem to have gotten worse.
Michael, one of the things I love about you is I'm confident since you were 5 years old, you've been the old man yelling, get off my lawn.
I came out of the womb with a cigar in my teeth, you know, hair parted. Yes.
And your mother's still ticked off about that.
She is. It hurts. It hurts. Yeah.
Look, we need to be, particularly in the so-called elite institutions, willing to think for ourselves. You're right. Schools like Yale, the students are told all the time, you are the leaders of the world. You are the future Bill Clintons of the world.
The kid who wrote that op-ed calling for people to boycott us, he said there is a great power and responsibility that comes with being a Yalie. The kid is 18 years old. This is what these students are told.
Look, and I think it's part of why, if anything, the censorship is greater because the fear is greater. At an institution like this, every student here worked your tail off since you were in kindergarten. You were struggling with the perfect attendance. You were struggling to put the apple on the teacher's desk. You were struggling to be in student council and drama and debate and football and underwater basket. I don't even know what, but it was, you know, look, you recall the speech that it seems deans give about their a gazillion valedictorians in the world. We turn half of them down. Yeah. And that, when you get into a place like Yale, now, I wouldn't know, but I would imagine that, A, there's a sense of relief of, okay, all right, I've made it. But there's also a sense of terror of, oh, crap. Like, what if I lose it? What if I anger the gods of Yale?
Yeah.
Although I'm not sure God or man are allowed at Yale.
No more. Mostly demons and people of unspecified gender. Yeah.
But. Yeah. But look, it is when you've worked very hard for something, you're often afraid to lose it. And if you're afraid to lose it, you don't want to take risks. All right. I remember coming out of law school, coming out of a clerkship. So I clerked for a judge in the Court of Appeals, clerked on the Supreme Court. I'm clerking for Chief Justice Rehnquist, who was an amazing friend, an amazing boss. And I remember coming out, you got 36 Supreme Court law clerks coming out. And almost all of them were unbelievably risk averse. They were going to big fancy law firms because that's the next blue chip thing to do, unless you go become law professors and then train other people to continue to perpetuate the cycle. Hmm. I remember when I came out, I went to a little bitty law firm. It had 6 lawyers, it was 9 months old. And I thought it was fascinating listening to a lot of my co-clerks. They were like, well, wait, that's really risky. Why would you do that? You don't know if this firm is gonna survive. You don't know if it'll go under. And listen, when I was looking for a law firm, I was looking for lawyers I wanted to work for, lawyers that I wanted to come carry their briefcase and just, you know, the way Abraham Lincoln learned to be a lawyer was literally carrying a briefcase and studying and apprenticing under someone. That's still the best way to become a lawyer. And I remember the other clerk said, well, what if it goes bankrupt? Or like the lead lawyer at the firm is a guy named Chuck Cooper, one of the top Supreme Court lawyers in the country, a very dear friend. And they said, well, you know, Chuck Cooper could become the U.S. Solicitor General in another Republican administration. He could become the top lawyer for the government, for the United States in front of the Supreme Court. I remember thinking, why is it a bad thing if your boss, when you're brand new and starting your career, goes on to become the top lawyer for the United States of America in the Supreme Court? And why would you want to work for someone who wouldn't be considered for that job?
Right.
And fine, if it's a little bitty law firm and it's 9 months old, if they go bankrupt in a year, you know what? I felt confident I could get another job.
Yeah.
Like if there's any value to working your tail off and trying to build some academic credentials and a history, it was like, look, I don't think I'm unemployable.
Yeah.
It took politics to make me unemployable. But that, I remember being fascinated at the mindset of the clerks that they had worked so hard that risk terrified them. And I think you see that manifested at universities across the country, but I think the Ivy League, it is more intense because there's more fear of the risk and the uncertainty.
I've seen exactly that. I remember it when I was in college, I guess it was 10 years ago now. But I, as far as I can tell, visiting campuses, things remain the same. The students at these name brand schools.
You know, 10 years ago, Joe Biden was vice president.
That's true.
According to Obama, he still is.
That's a good point. So, gosh, now you're bringing me back to the worst memory I have in college. I just got there freshman year. I'm so excited.
We don't need you to share all that.
No, and it's not that one. It's not that one. Don't worry. No, I had just gotten here, and it was the 2008 election. And I thought, oh, this is going to be great. I'm going to have such a great time on campus. And then Obama wins. And 3,000 people, I don't know, thousands of people come out. They're celebrating. You see wafts of marijuana clouds coming up from the green. You see people drinking outside. And in a dorm on old campus, one of the freshman dorms, it's me and about 6 other Republicans just drinking vodka out of the handle, say, oh no, everything's going downhill. But I did notice this with the conservatives.
It's actually very similar to your preparation routine for the podcast.
It's true. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. You know, it's obviously worked a long time. I noticed this with the campus conservatives. They're willing to wear the bow tie, generally. They're willing to go and advocate for lower taxes and deregulation, maybe even smaller government. But on a lot of, say, cultural issues, the issues that the ruling elite really don't want you to touch, they won't touch them either. They'll sometimes say things like, I'm a conservative, but I'm not that kind of a conservative. No, no, I'm still a fashionable one. And I think it's to protect the job at Goldman Sachs. I think it is that same risk aversion that you're describing.
Look, I think you're right, and I think you see in the conservative world generally people being cautious and risk averse. And part of it is, look, everyone likes to be liked, particularly young people. I mean, there's a reason peer pressure is a thing.
Right.
You know, you're at college, you want to go out, you want to have a good time. You know, ideally, you'd like to find someone you think is attractive and, you know, see what happens. Although I remember when I showed up as a college freshman, there was a T-shirt that was popular. It said on the front, "Sex kills." And on the back, it said, "Come to Princeton, live forever." There's a lot of truth to that. But, and look, people are, there is no doubt the positive peer pressure. When I was in school, when you were in school, but even more so today, that if you take an unpopular position, you risk being denigrated, you risk being ostracized. And so people opt at a minimum to just shut up about it.
Yeah.
To just say, you know what, I'm going to keep my views quiet. How you come through that, I think, is one of the real testing aspects of education.
Hmm. Right, right. Can you withstand that? Or, like the vast majority, do you just kind of go along, go with the flow, go along with the crowd, and lose whatever principle you might have had? This does bring us to your colleagues, Senator. In the United States Senate, your Republican colleagues, we have just confirmed a woman that you say is the most radical Supreme Court justice in the history of this country. I agree. The person cannot tell you what a woman is, and she is supportive of critical race theory, talks about the founders of that movement by name. She has lauded the 1619 Project, which says America's evil from the very beginning. It's based on a false thesis about slavery. So this woman is very far to the left, and yet when I looked at the Senate confirmation hearings over who was grilling Ketanji Jackson, it was you and Josh Hawley and Tom Cotton a little bit. And that was pretty much it. And all of the other Republican senators were sitting there twiddling their thumbs and in some cases actually encouraging this woman, who's now the furthest left judge we've ever had on the court. What gives?
Well, look, risk aversion doesn't end when you're 21. It doesn't end when you're in college. It doesn't end when you're in grad school. It doesn't end when you start your first job. And in the world of politics, if you dare to take on the orthodoxy, you get demonized. I promise you in the, 20 minutes we've been sitting here, there have been 1,000 tweets telling me to go do things that are anatomically impossible.
Good night, everybody.
Look, it is, and if you're a Republican senator, it is not complicated that this nomination was an historic first. Anytime a Republican opposes a Democratic Supreme Court nomination, you are certain to be vilified by the media. All the more so if that nominee happens to be the first African-American woman nominated to the court. It means going into it, you know to a certainty, if you say anything, if you say good morning, you'll be called a racist. You'll be called a sexist. You'll be demonized. And look, today's Democrats, that's their opening line to begin with, no matter what you say. But in this context, I can tell you, among the Republican senators, most of them went into this nomination scared of their own shadow. They didn't want to be held up as the modern-day Klansmen, which if you said any critical question, that was the attack that was coming.
Yeah.
On top of that, look, why is it we care about who's on the Supreme Court? This is something I care deeply about. I think a lot of Americans care deeply about it. The reason I believe we care about it is the Supreme Court has been the institution throughout history that has played the most pivotal role for protecting our fundamental rights. for protecting free speech, for protecting religious liberty, for protecting the right to keep and bear arms, for protecting our safety and security of our families by ensuring that the criminal laws are enforced. You know, this nomination was one that I'll confess I felt conflicted about. I've known Ketanji for 30 years. We were in law school together. We were 1 year apart in law school. We were on the law review together. She is someone that, on a personal level, she's very smart, she's charming, she has an easy smile. Everybody who knows her likes her. But at the end of the day, a Supreme Court nomination is not about whether someone is smart or talented or whether you like them. It is about what their record is, and what kind of job they will do in the position. And as I examined her record, I came to the conclusion that her record demonstrated that she will be the furthest left of any of the justices that have ever served on the court. Yeah. Now, there's some people that want... Actually, that to me is comforting. It's comforting that there are that many people applauding, because that suggests that there's a wide difference of opinion in this room. I think that's fantastic. I'm actually glad for everyone who applauded there, because if you're left of center, thank you for coming out. Thank you for being part of a conversation. If you're starting from a perspective that you don't agree with me, if you're starting from a perspective that you don't agree with Michael, then it is wonderfully and refreshingly open-minded that you're here and willing to have this conversation, that you don't start from the perspective of, I can't hear you. That's very positive, but I do think in the confirmation of now Justice Jackson, her record was far out of the mainstream.
And it's worth pointing out, too, because now President Biden is trying to suggest that this was the most vicious attack on any Supreme Court nominee in history. When Brett Kavanaugh was up, they called him a gang rapist without any evidence whatsoever. And because of the testimony of a woman who contradicted herself many times and whose testimony was contradicted by everyone who was even supposedly around her at the time, by another woman who certainly never met Brett Kavanaugh ever, and by a felon lawyer who's currently doing time for wire fraud. So,
CNN said he could be the Democratic presidential nominee.
You're right, a felon lawyer who may still become the Democrat nominee someday. And so you had that. With the Ketanji Jackson confirmation process, you, Senator, and a couple of your colleagues just quoted her court opinions.
Yeah, you know, it reminds me of one of my favorite podcasts you and I did was over a year ago with a fellow named Eric Weinstein, yeah, who's a very bright man, brilliant man, but he's politically left of center. And we had a long pod with a pretty vigorous discussion on lots of issues. Yeah. But I remember the topic of Supreme Court nominations came up, and he made a point. He said, well, they're nasty, but everybody does it. Both sides do it. You know, it's just the nature of politics. And as you'll recall, and by the way, I'd encourage you, that's a fun podcast to go back and listen to, because we had some very, I think, substantive discussions and disagreements, respectful and civil. But the point I made to him is I said, look, that's not true. If you look at the really nasty confirmations, the confirmations that got personal and ugly, it's only one party that does this. Whether it was Robert Bork, whether it was Clarence Thomas, or whether it was Brett Kavanaugh, it has been the Democrats that go into the gutter with the kind of personal attacks that those confirmation hearings featured. And Republicans have not, and I don't believe will, engaged in that. And, you know, it was interesting. Oh, I think 2 weeks ago, I was talking with a reporter in the Capitol. I was making this point to him. And this is a left-leaning reporter. And he said, well, you know, I don't know about that. I mean, you know, the child pornography stuff, that was pretty hard-hitting. And I said, well, yes, it was. But there's a difference. There's a difference, which is that she has a record as a sitting federal judge of imposing sentences in over a dozen child pornography cases in front of her. And what we're questioning her about is her actual record from the bench, the sentences she imposed for people convicted of serious felonies. Yeah. And in fact, a lot of the questioning was literally reading what she said from the bench in a robe while exercising the judicial power of the United States. That's what a confirmation is supposed to be about. You didn't see any of us pulling out her high school yearbook.
Judge, how many beers did you have with PJ and Squee? You didn't know them in the summer of 82? Okay.
Look, it is... We're supposed to engage in an examination of someone's record to examine what kind of judge or justice they would be. The reason those cases were hard-hitting is that her record in terms of sentencing sexual predators, in particular those convicted of either possession or distribution of child pornography, was dramatically more lenient than the average among federal judges across the country. And it was out of step. And at the hearings, I tried to give her an opportunity. I said, all right, the Democrats are saying we're cherry picking. So let's go through each one of the cases you had. And I want to give you, Judge, a chance to explain why you sentence this defendant to so much less than the guidelines provide, so much less than the prosecutor had asked for, why you sentence to such extremely low sentences. And throughout the hearing, she proffered no defense of the sentences. The Democrats proffered no defense of the sentences. The media proffered no defense of the sentences. They all tried, bizarrely enough, they tried to pretend it was some sort of like QAnon conspiracy. Now, listen, it may be news to the corporate media, but there are a lot of sexual offenders out there. I've worked in law enforcement a lot of years. There are people who do horrible, horrible things, and especially do horrible things to kids. And we have criminal cases. And look, most of us would like to see people who commit horrible, violent crimes sentenced to very serious sentences. Her record was out of the mainstream, and yet you're right. Joe Biden, at the speech at the White House this past week, tried to paint this story that it was like this horrible, vicious treatment because she was read her own words as a judge sitting on the bench imposing criminal sentences. That's what a confirmation hearing is supposed to be about.
I agree. And before we get to the wonderful leftists in the room who will get a chance to ask questions and perhaps try to refute things that we've said, we always have this rule, if you disagree with us, you get to cut to the front of the line. This really doesn't jibe with my authoritarian tendencies, but we deal with it. We let it happen. It's fine. So we will get to that. Before that, though, I do want to close out this issue of the confirmation. Where was the conservative movement?
So look, it's a very good question. This past week, I sat down with a number of leaders of the conservative movement, and I got to say, the movement, most of the organizations right of center were largely absent from the fight over Ketanji Brown Jackson. And I think the reasons were a couple of fold. One, I think conservative groups and organizations, just like a lot of Republican senators, were terrified of being vilified for daring to oppose the first African-American woman nominated to the court. So they didn't want to have the fight. Secondly, there is a reasoning that many people found persuasive, which is that Justice Jackson was nominated to replace Stephen Breyer. Stephen Breyer is a left-of-center justice. And so the argument went, you're replacing one left-of-center justice for another. It doesn't change the underlying balance of power on the court, so it's not worth the fight. Now, I'm not convinced that's right. I will say, of the left-leaning justices on the court, Breyer has been the most conservative of the liberals, which is not to say remotely conservative. But to give an example, you know, one of the cases that I litigated when I was Solicitor General of Texas was a case called Van Orden versus Texas, Van Orden versus Perry, rather. And Van Orden versus Perry was challenging the display of the Ten Commandments monument on the state capitol grounds. And that case went all the way to the Supreme Court. At the end of the day, the Supreme Court upheld Texas's monument by a vote of 5-4. Now, what's interesting in that case is I had spent thousands of hours getting ready for that case, and we'd written our brief trying to really just mind meld with Sandra Day O'Connor, who Justice O'Connor at the time was the swing vote on the court. And so I tried to put every argument. In fact, one of the lawyers in my office asked, they said, Ted, is it possible to be too obsequious to Justice O'Connor? And I said, no,
certainly
it is not.
I
want the most common words in this brief to be O'Connor, comma, J. I want them more common than and or the. And if we can put an oil portrait of Justice O'Connor on the cover of our brief, I think that would be tasteful and appropriate. Well, I tried to pitch all of those arguments. Every argument I aimed at Justice O'Connor missed. And she voted to strike down the monument. And yet, amazingly, the arguments that I aimed at Justice O'Connor found fertile ground with Stephen Breyer, and Justice Breyer was our necessary fifth vote. We won 5-4 because Steve Breyer voted to uphold the Texas Ten Commandments monument. Now, I will say we are replacing who was the most conservative of the left-leaning justices with a justice who I believe, and to be honest, you can only assess these things after a decade or two, so we'll know sometime in the future whether this prediction is right, but based on her record, I think she will prove to be the furthest left of those justices. That's a meaningful shift. But I got to tell you, it was amazing. So we're engaged in this confirmation hearing, and normally in a judicial confirmation hearing, particularly a Supreme Court fight, there's an ecosystem on right and left that rise up. So when Brett Kavanaugh was nominated, there's all these left-leaning groups that are funded with millions of dollars that are attacking him, that are funding attacks, by the way, that are sending protesters to Washington to show up in the hearing and scream and yell and yell at senators in elevators. There's an elevator we call the Jeff Flake Memorial Elevator because it's where these protesters who were on the payroll of a leftist organization screamed at him. I'm glad that you didn't see conservatives hiring people just to scream and yell and throw a fit. But they also engage in research. And what was fascinating, so when the issue about her lenient sentences came up, the first response that Democrats had was, well, a lot of federal judges sentence defendants, particularly defendants in child pornography cases, to below the federal sentencing guidelines. And that argument is actually a reasonable argument. If you look just at the first iteration of the back and forth, they had a reasonable point with some real basis for it. The next iteration of the argument, however, was she was not just sentencing below the guideline. She was sentencing far, far, far below what the prosecutor was asking for in each case. Every case where she had discretion, she went way below the prosecutor. And then, as we're talking about it amidst Republican senators, several Republican senators asked the question, well, how does her sentencing compare to other federal judges across the country? It's a good question. It was a reasonable question. I asked my team initially, I said, look, surely someone is doing comprehensive research on a record. This ought to be available. So my team reached out to the likely organizations that would be doing this research. Nobody done any research.
You know that it, had the situation been reversed, the left would have a dossier 5 inches thick.
And they did. They did for Neil Gorsuch. They did for Amy Coney Barrett. They did for Brett Kavanaugh. For all three, massive amounts of money were spent. Ultimately, in my office, I directed my chief counsel and my legal team, all right, I want you to go do the empirical analysis of how Judge Jackson's sentences compare to the average federal judge. And what we discovered is in all criminal cases, she's sentenced on average 34% lower than the average federal judge. On possession of child pornography, she's sentenced 58% less than the average federal judge. And on distribution of child pornography, she's sentenced 47% less than the average federal judge. That was research my team did because there was not the supporting ecosphere providing that research. And I'll tell you one fascinating thing. I'd be willing to bet there are not five people in this room who know who Wesley Hawkins is. Now, that says something. We're at Yale. This is a place where people are informed, are educated, are following closely.
He's been reading the brochure in the admissions office.
That's what it says. So Wesley Hawkins was the most egregious of the cases before Judge Jackson. Wesley Hawkins was an 18-year-old man who was convicted of possession of really graphic, horrific child pornography. And in that case for Wesley Hawkins, the sentencing guidelines provided for 8 to 10 years as a jail sentence. The prosecutor came in, now this is in DC, the prosecutors lean left, they knew that Judge Jackson imposed very light sentences in these cases, which the prosecutors say in open court, Judge, we know you don't like these cases, but here's why it's really bad. The prosecutor asked for 2 years. Judge Jackson sentenced him to 3 months. And her explanation at the sentencing hearing, she expresses how sorry she is to the criminal defendant, how sorry she is to his family. She expresses how sorry she is for the stigma that sex offenders have. And then her explanation for why the sentence was so light is she said, look, you're young, you were just curious, and the people in these videos were your peers. They're essentially the same age. Now, he was an 18-year-old man. These videos showed children as young as 8 years old being violently sexually assaulted. And I'm sorry, an 8-year-old boy is not the peer right. of an 18-year-old man. And the point I make about no ecosphere, in any reasonable world, there would be people here who know about Wesley Hawkins, who know about that case, and who would want to know why, in the face of those horrific facts, did she think it was appropriate to sentence him to just 3 months, and yet the media wouldn't report on it. And it is striking, virtually no one knows right. the facts of that case. That's a failure. It's a deliberate failure of the media, but it is also...
It's a failure of the conservative movement.
The movement did nothing to inform anyone of the facts of this very disturbing case.
The movement should have come up with all the fodder for the tough questions. Now, speaking of tough questions, I want to get some tough questions from the audience. Shall we bring out our friend Liz Wheeler to field the questions?
Absolutely.
Let's do it.
Welcome
Hello.
Back.
Thank you, thank you. I just want to say, I noticed that when you were throwing the merch out at the beginning, the hats and the shirts, that you didn't have enough for the whole audience. So I just want to let everyone know, if you use my promo code LIVE, you can get 10% off on
Shameless.
The verdict with TedCruz.com/shop on the merch store. This is what we call a shameless plug. Mm-hmm.
By the way, Liz, I got to say, one of the coolest things that's set up here that I just saw shortly before we started filming is somehow we've gotten to be able to project the cactus on the wall, which I just think is really cool. We've never done that before, so whoever came up with that was very clever.
They're going to paint it afterward as a monument to this show and our visit.
I think that's right, and then we'll all be prosecuted for vandalism.
I think it's very complimentary to the chandelier look. Mm-hmm. So are we ready for some questions?
Yes.
All right. First, go to verdictwithtedcruz.com/shop. There you go, while people are lining up.
All right, do we have microphones somewhere? All right, we got a microphone there. Mm-hmm.
I'll be handling questions, everyone. If you could line up in the back of the house, my colleague will direct you up to the front, where you'll stand on the green tape to my side. Please ask a question that ends with a question mark, and also be brief.
And the rule really does stand. I know I joked sincerely about how much I hate the rule, but if you disagree with us, you really are allowed to cut to the front of the line. So just indicate that up there, and we look forward to hearing from you.
William F. Buckley Jr. used to say, a conservative is someone who stands athwart history yelling stop. Does this definition still apply to today's political climate?
Ooh, good question.
Something that is misunderstood about that statement is he was speaking about history with a capital H. He was speaking about the Marxist conception of history as a science that can be known with certainty, and it comes from a popular line from the left, which is, I have seen the future and it works. And so Buckley is responding to that and saying, no, whatever you think the future is, we are going to stand athwart that, yelling stop. And so the statement is perfectly right, in as much as Buckley is saying in the 1950s, the conservative is one who is stopping communism. And he brought together a coalition of three disparate groups: the traditionalists, who hated the iconoclasm and atheism of the Soviet Union, the libertarians, who hated the collectivism, and the war hawk Democrats, for lack of a better word, the people who hated the USSR's imperial ambitions. And those three groups didn't have a whole lot in common, but they had a common enemy. And so they fought the Soviet Union, and they won. I mean, for all that we knock that coalition today, it was successful, and it did win the Cold War. So I think he was perfectly right at the time to say that. The Berlin Wall fell 30 years ago, and conservatives who are just playing reruns of the 1980s on YouTube, frankly, I myself sometimes do it as comfort food, you know? I go in on a cozy night and play old Reagan clips, but that isn't going to cut it.
I'm confident with your wife. That's very romantic.
It's so romantic. Say, honey, just one more, please. You know, Ronald Reagan and Bill Buckley fought their battles, and now they're resting. Let them rest. Don't dig up their bodies and try to revivify them. Learn from them. I mean, that's something that we're trying to do here at the Buckley program, right? The William F. Buckley Jr. program at Yale isn't about playing the hits from the 80s or the 70s or the 60s. It's about applying timeless principles and an understanding of the conservative tradition to the real circumstances today.
So, Michael, I have to say I'm deeply disappointed that we are in New Haven, Connecticut.
Mm-hmm.
We're at your alma mater.
Mm-hmm.
You just got asked a question about William Buckley. And you sat up straight.
Yep, no, you're right.
And argued in plain, clearly enunciated English. Could you try it again and answer it appropriately?
Well, I'll be joined for the full hour today by Senator Ted Cruz. If I do not do my William F. Buckley Jr. impression, he will smash me in my damn face. I will stay plastered to. Does that do it?
Very nice.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate it.
And this is demonstration. Before he became a podcaster, Michael was a frustrated actor.
Mm-hmm. And before that, half a wasp. So I've been trying my blue blood accent for a while. Yep.
All right, our next question is actually going to be from Verdict Plus. If you are a subscriber on Verdict Plus, this community, you get exclusive access to ask the senator questions, not just in live events, but on a regular basis. That's where we also host the cloakroom. So this next question is from username Godzilla Rules. This is the question, Senator. I picked it because of the question, I promise, not because of the username. That was just part of it. Senator, if Republicans take the House, who would be the Speaker?
It's a good question. I think the answer probably will be Kevin McCarthy. I will say this. I stay out of speaker elections. I've got enough battles on the Senate side of things. When I arrived in the Senate, John Boehner was the speaker. Boehner and I...
Good friends.
let me just say we had pretty significant differences of opinion, to put it mildly. I think it is likely that McCarthy, if there's a majority, will be Speaker. Now, it's not clear he will stay Speaker. The job of Speaker of the House is a very difficult job. It is like herding cats. There is wide disagreement among Republicans, and I think if there's discontent in the ranks, he could be replaced. But I think given that he's been Republican leader in the minority, given that he's working very hard to take the majority, I would be surprised if House Republicans didn't at least give him the first crack at leading, and if he does a good job, then presumably he'll stay Speaker.
Well, conservative critics would say that he leans too establishment and that he's not based enough. What say you to...
I love, Liz, how you phrase that. You know, some conservative critics might say...
You know, conservative critics whose name rhyme with Wiz Leeler.
Perhaps. That's the fun part of moderating the questions, is I get to throw my own in.
So look, I have been through now multiple Republican leaders in the House. When I arrived, it was John Boehner. Boehner loathed conservatives. There are conservatives in the House, and it was interesting because he had started out as a relatively conservative House member before he began climbing the rungs of leadership. But by the time he was Speaker, I would encounter House Republicans who would just tell me about it. He'd walk up to them on the floor and just say, F you, like to their face. And Boehner's kind of an interesting fellow in that he's had all sorts of interesting things to say about me. He's described me as Lucifer in the flesh. he's described me as the most miserable son of a bitch he's ever worked with.
Mm-hmm.
And the irony is I've never worked with him. So I don't know John Boehner. My whole life I have not spoken 50 words to Boehner. So it's kind of a curious thing. And so he came out with a book recently that I think nobody read. although when he was recording his video for it, he did a video of the audiobook and he's drinking copious amounts of red wine and chain smoking. And in the middle of the video, he's reading a segment of the book completely unrelated. And he looks in the camera and says, F you, Ted Cruz, like in the middle of the video. And so a friend of mine gave me this book. It may have been the one copy purchased. And so I did what's called the Washington Read. So the Washington Read is you take a book, you go look in the index to see what they say about you, and you go skim through to figure out what it is. So I did that, said, all right, let's see what he has to say. And what was fascinating, he actually describes why he loathes me so much. And he said, look, when Cruz arrived in January of 2013, he said the crazies among the House Republicans, by which he means the conservatives, they had been largely beaten down. And Cruz got there, and he convinced them suddenly they believed they could fight for something. Suddenly they believed they could do something. And he said, and that made my life miserable. So that was Boehner when it started. Ultimately, I think he was so antagonistic to conservatives, it cost him the speakership. He was toppled ultimately. The next speaker was Paul Ryan. Paul Ryan was substantially less antagonistic to conservatives than Boehner. Now, Paul had been in Washington a long time. Paul had been, when he arrived, he was a young Turk charging the castle. And I think after 20 years, the Paul Ryan 20 years into it was very different from the Paul Ryan who had first arrived in Washington. But Paul had a better relationship with conservatives in the House. He was no longer one of them, but it was less actively antagonistic than Boehner had been. You now have McCarthy, and McCarthy, it's interesting. I think ideologically, Kevin is the most moderate of the three. If you actually look at where Kevin's personal views are, he's the least conservative of the three. But he also is the least antagonistic to House conservatives. And right now, I would say House conservatives get along with him pretty well. Now, in some ways, it's easier to get along with the leader of House Republicans when you're in the minority. When you're in the minority and everyone's voting no, there are fewer fracture lines for disagreement. Yep. I think we're more likely to find disagreement next year, if we see Republican majorities in both houses. Look, the singular cause of the disagreements I've had with Mitch McConnell, and Mitch and I have battled like crazy in the Senate, the major cause of those has been on the question of how much can we stand up and fight the agenda, whether a Barack Obama or Joe Biden. And so with McCarthy, I think time will tell how he navigates those waters. I'm less concerned about where he personally is ideologically, and I'm more concerned if and when he becomes Speaker with how he leads and whether I'm a big believer when you got the majority, you got to do something with it. Doesn't mean you fight everything. If you fight everything, you're fighting nothing. But it does mean that you pick some issues that matter, that you care about, and you stand up and fight and make a difference. And I think if Kevin does that, he'll be more likely to keep the job. And if he doesn't, he may not.
Right.
So it's called accountability. And you have no idea how many pitches I have tonight, but if you want to ask a question and you're not in the audience, join verdictwithtedcruz.com/plus. I have a whole paper of them, guys. Now to your question. What's your name?
Okay, thank you. My name is Maya Cook.
Good evening, Senator Cruz. Thank you so much for coming to Yale this evening. And I think in the spirit of the Buckley Program's celebration of intellectual diversity, I wanted to take a moment to celebrate our newest addition to the Supreme Court of the U.S., who I know we've already talked about, Justice Jackson. Since you're here tonight, though, in the name of fostering intellectual diversity in academic spaces, it would appear to me that you already recognize the importance of new perspectives. And as a young woman, seeing Justice Jackson on the Supreme Court is invigorating, truly. And on Tuesday, it baffled me that you would ask such flagrantly racist questions to this exceedingly well-qualified candidate. Your colleagues in the GOP promised a respectful and dignified hearing for Justice Jackson, and to me, you did not uphold this. So today, I wanted to create a space where you might be able to challenge your own thinking, as prudent scholars often do. So I'm here to ask you, what are two nice comments you can give about recent nominee Justice Jackson's judicial experience, besides from she has an easy smile?
Yeah, you racist. What's the comment? Well, let me start by thanking you for being here, and thank you for asking a substantive, important question. Thank you for engaging in a conversation. I think we all would be better off if we engage in substantive conversations. There's a lot to praise about Judge Jackson. She is very, very bright. She is very, very accomplished. She is very talented. She has an impressive and inspiring personal story. I will say, sitting listening to her opening remarks, where she described her personal story, she described her parents' journey, you had to be dead not to be inspired by that journey. And listen, I will say more broadly, if you look at the history of our country, if you look at the history of our country on race, it is absolutely inspiring to see an African-American woman serving on the Supreme Court. I will also point out that when it comes to issues of race, I think both the press and the modern left are hypocritical on this question, that they only define someone as black or they only define someone as Hispanic if they agree with them ideologically. So Clarence Thomas has been on the court for decades. Clarence Thomas is a black man. The left hates him. They despise Clarence Thomas. And I'll tell you, by the way, the treatment of Clarence Thomas on the left is markedly different than, say, Antonin Scalia. Antonin Scalia was brilliant. He and Justice Thomas were every bit as conservative. And yet, the vitriol that was heaped on Clarence Thomas, nasty, racist language from the left. There was one magazine cover that showed Clarence Thomas as an Uncle Tom sitting at Scalia's feet. I think was racist and disgusting. And listen, I will say this as an Hispanic man. As an Hispanic man, Jorge Ramos went on television in Spanish and described me as a traitor to my race for daring. Okay, look, that says something about the view of the left, that they're telling you, you have one way to view things and one way only. And if you don't, we'll demonize and attack you. So look, and by the way, in terms of having the first African-American woman on the Supreme Court, there was an opportunity for this to happen 20 years ago. There's a judge named Janice Rogers Brown. Janice Rogers Brown was a Supreme Court justice on the California Supreme Court. George W. Bush nominated Janice Rogers Brown to the D.C. Circuit. At the beginning of his presidency, he nominated Judge Brown to the D.C. Circuit. The Democrats filibustered Judge Brown. That filibuster was led by a guy named Joe Biden. It also included people like Chuck Schumer. It included Pat Leahy, included Dianne Feinstein. The reason they filibustered Judge Janice Rogers Brown is because she was a black woman, but she was also conservative. And they did not want her to go to the Supreme Court. And they succeeded in filibustering her. They delayed her nomination for a couple of years until it finally went through. She finally went to the D.C. Circuit. Now, everyone who was harumphing in the media
that if you oppose an African-American woman who's a qualified judge, you're a racist. Precisely zero of them thought it was racist for Democrats, including Joe Biden, to filibuster Janice Rogers Brown. By the way, there was another nominee that Bush put forward, a guy named Miguel Estrada. Miguel is an incredibly qualified Supreme Court advocate. He was nominated the D.C. Circuit as well. The Democrats filibustered him. If you read the memos that were leaked from Ted Kennedy's lawyers, here's what Ted Kennedy's lawyers said about Miguel Estrada. They said, we must stop him, quote, because he is Hispanic. That's what Ted Kennedy's lawyers said in writing. Now, I'm going to suggest to you, if you oppose somebody because of their race, that is the definition of racist. And look, I'll point out in your question, you said that my questioning of Judge Jackson was you used the term racist. Listen, racism is a horrific evil in this country. It is also an insult that the left tosses around casually. I would welcome, if you look at the questions I asked Judge Jackson, every single question I asked her concerned her record. Either her record as a judge, sentencing defendants before her, or her record writing academic materials and law reviews, or her record giving speeches to law schools. All of that is the job of the Senate in the advice and consent process. And so, respectfully, I could not disagree more deeply when you say it is racist to examine a judge based on their record. If the Democrats wanted to oppose Janice Rogers Brown because they oppose conservatives, you know, do you think the Democrats were all sexist when they voted party line against Amy Coney Barrett? I'm willing to bet you don't, because she's not a liberal woman. So you can't have it both ways, which is that when a Democratic nominee has a certain characteristic, anyone who opposes them is racist or sexist or what have you. But when a Republican nominee has those characteristics, it's open season and you can go after them full force and the left is righteous in doing so. The standard should be the same, and I'm going to suggest what the standard should be, is we should examine people based on their actual record and whether and to what extent that record demonstrates they will defend the constitutional rights of all Americans. I think that's what people care about.
One thing, as a young professional woman similar to you, I do want to speak to...
And I often get called a young professional woman.
Every day.
However you identify. I do think it's important to look at exactly what happened with Ketanji Brown Jackson as it relates to the progress that women have made in our country. And by that, I mean how Joe Biden has taken us backwards in the progress that we have made moving away from sexism. Because when conservatives say that Ketanji Brown Jackson was nominated by Joe Biden because of her race and because of her gender, we're not inferring that. Joe Biden said that himself. He said he was going to nominate someone because she was a woman and because she was a black woman. And as women, ourselves, as minorities, this should be extremely insulting to us. It reduces us to tokens. It is tokenism. It's racial tokenism and it's sexism. And This is the fundamental problem with the idea of equity, right? It leaves women wondering, did I get the job based on my qualifications and my resume, or did I get the job because I am part of a gender quota, because I have been reduced to my genitalia? And so I would challenge young women to reject what Joe Biden has done. I would challenge young women to acknowledge that this is actually racial discrimination and gender discrimination, and the people who lose the most are women who not only are they left to wonder about themselves, their coworkers and their colleagues are also left to wonder, did this black woman achieve what she achieved based on her merits or because of the color of her skin or her gender?
Hello, my
My name is Evan. Assuming that would end global hunger, would you fillet another man?
Dare I ask him to repeat? Well, actually, so I do have an answer to this.
All right, I actually think it is better that the Yale answer this.
You know, there was a line in American Psycho about that Yale thing. I think that's what our questioner is alluding to. Like a typical left-wing undergraduate, you are engaging in consequentialist ethics. You are attempting to justify flagrantly immoral behavior to achieve a good end. And I tell you, my friend, the ends do not justify the means. Absolutely. Absolutely not.
I am curious with that young fellow, if it would solve world hunger, would you vote for Donald Trump?
Hello, Senator Cruz. My name is Priya, and I'm a community college transfer student and current undergrad junior at Yale. Are you aware of the radical left protests occurring on the popular mobile game Among Us? What are you doing to protect our youth from this and other online indoctrination?
So I'll confess I'm not,
you don't say.
All right, so Among Us, I've played it a couple of times with my daughters. And it's sort of fun, but if there's a radical protest on it, I don't know about it.
You always surprise me. I haven't even heard of this, and you're totally hip to the jive of this game.
Well, wow. You know, it. You know, when you have a 13-year-old and an 11-year-old, I grew up driving from LaGuardia to Yale. I played video games the whole way here. But. I did not play Among Us, so if there is a protest, I don't know about it.
All right, our next question I could pretend is from Verdict Plus, but it's actually my question. Hmm. I want to hear your discussion of this topic. There was a piece that was published today by David French regarding the anti-groomer bill, the parental rights and education bill in Florida, the left calls it the Don't Say Gay bill. He accuses conservatives of being anti-free speech. In fact, he calls conservatives hypocrites for trying to control what teachers are instructing children in the classroom, given that conservatives generally support free speech. So my question to both of you is, are conservatives hypocrites when it comes to these parental rights and education bills?
Are we laws? Hypocrites because we don't want the kindergarten teachers to trans the kids? That's the question.
Yes.
Okay. I don't think so. I don't think it's in the free speech tradition of America to preach transgenderism to five-year-olds. I have a test. It's the What Would Washington Do test. If you talk to the founding fathers, you said, do you believe that you founded this country to protect the sacred right of weirdos to indoctrinate five-year-olds into transgenderism and other assorted ideologies? I don't think they would have said, yes, by golly. That's why we fought the revolution. What about slavery? I don't think they're teaching a lot about slavery in kindergarten, which is probably a good thing. But
what would the founding fathers have to say about slavery?
What would the founding fathers?
Well, that's a good question.
That is actually
that's
a good question. What would the founding fathers say about slavery?
Well, you want to repeat it just because it wasn't in the microphone, so folks at home can hear.
The question was, what would the founding fathers say about slavery? And frankly, the answer is we'd be here all night because a lot of them vigorously oppose slavery. Some of them own slaves. Some of the ones who own slaves recognized the moral problem of slavery and wanted to end it, and they set up ways for it to end through the Constitution, and there were vigorous debates. The country almost fell apart. We almost didn't get a Constitution because of that issue. So the answer is it's complicated and would be interesting. But that wasn't the question I was asked. The question on David French saying that conservatives are hypocrites regarding free speech because we don't want kindergartners learning about transgenderism is silly to me because, one, kindergarten classrooms are not exactly a rollicking free marketplace of ideas where we're discovering new scientific technologies and things like that. No, you're learning your ABCs. But furthermore, even on this issue of academic freedom, there is no right of a teacher to teach whatever that teacher wants in a classroom, specifically to kindergartners. It's funny to hear that kind of a question here at the William F. Buckley Jr. program. The conservative movement was founded with a book called God and Man at Yale. Everyone remembers the title. Few people remember the subtitle, which is the superstitions of academic freedom, which he put in scare quotes. He said that academic freedom is a hoax, that it's a superstition that was merely instrumental for the left to get rid of all of the old norms. He quotes the former Yale president, Charles Seymour, who says that skepticism has utility only when it leads to conviction. Later on, Bill Buckley was having a debate with Leo Churn on Firing Line. Buckley said, "I do not want a more open society. I want the society to be considerably more closed." He used the phrase epistemological optimism, by which he meant that we can know certain things, we can settle certain things. Buckley said he felt no desire to protect the rights of a Nazi or of a communist. David French infamously defended Drag Queen Story Hour on the suggestion that if we don't protect the right of drag queens to jiggle around for little kids, then by golly, they might not let us go to church on Sundays. And first of all, the left has prevented us from going to church on Sundays for about the past 2 years with the COVID lockdowns. But even beyond that, if we can't tell the difference between twerking for little kids in skimpy outfits at the library and a pastor preaching the gospel on Sunday, then we do not possess the rational faculties and the moral conscience to govern ourselves.
So I've got a different take on the matter, and one of the reasons this podcast can be interesting and fun is that Michael and I have fairly different worldviews. Michael is very Burkean. He is very comfortable with tradition. He is very comfortable with lack of change. I was amazed to see you disagree in any way with Buckley standing athwart, and by the way, athwart's a word used far too rarely in life, athwart history yelling stop. I'm far more libertarian. I am far more live and let live. When it comes to free speech, I embrace free speech. And I embrace free speech not just for people I agree with, but for people I disagree with. I embrace free speech, you know, you mentioned for Nazis and communists. I think Nazis and communists have free speech rights. Now, reasonable people ought to disagree with Nazis and communists. We ought to battle them with more free speech. But I very much agree with John Stuart Mill that the best cure for bad speech is more speech. And so I think academic freedom actually matters, and even academic freedom for people who are nutty. That being said, though, I think the Florida law and the other states that are considering laws is markedly different, which is that if a state is going to have a public school system, it's going to set curriculum. That is inherent in the process of having a school system. And if you're setting curriculum, you're making a choice of what is included in the curriculum and what is excluded in the curriculum. And making that choice is not in and of itself a violation of free speech. You're necessarily sorting what do we think it is imperative that our kids learn. And the Florida bill, you know, it was interesting, the opponents of the bill, they dubbed it the Don't Say Gay bill. And yet the bill provided that for kids that were pre-kindergarten through third grade, that you should not discuss questions of sexuality. Look, pre-kindergarten kids are 3 and 4 years old. And I think it is perfectly reasonable for a state to say, we want kids in pre-K and K to be learning reading and writing and arithmetic, and they shouldn't be talking about sex. And by the way, I don't want straight teachers talking about straight sex to four-year-olds.
No sex in kindergarten.
You know, kids go to kindergarten to learn to play blocks, to learn to get some basic education. And by the way, the Florida law ended at third grade. At fourth grade, it was, hey, Katie, bar the door, you know, bring out the S&M, let's get explicit. So apparently at age 9, all was good. But prior to age 9, and what's fascinating, I think the cultural left jumped the shark on this. Because you saw many political Democrats, you saw the corporate media all excited, don't say gay. You saw Hollywood all chanting gay, 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 which I gotta say, is not an act of bravery to chant gay in Hollywood.
Mandatory, actually, is what it is.
But what's interesting is if you look at the polling of parents of Floridians who read the terms of this law, which is let's not teach little bitty kids about sex, the overwhelming majority of Floridians agreed with it, including the majority of Democrats in Florida. Yeah. So it's the cultural elites who are like, how dare you silence these brave truth tellers? You can do all the brave truth telling you want outside of the kindergarten classroom. Right. But I think that is an important distinction, that setting curriculum is very, very different from trying to silence people generally. And the question that was called out about what about slavery? Let me address that, because that's an important question. Listen, there's been a lot of debate about critical race theory, and something we've talked about a lot in this podcast. I think critical race theory is deeply pernicious. I think it is teaching young children revisionist history about America that is based on falsehoods and that is dividing them on racial lines. Now, the defenders of critical race theories have a series of inconsistent defenses they put forth. They start with, it's not being taught anywhere. They say no K through 12 school teaches critical race theory. It's only obscure grad schools in Yale. Then they say, it's not being taught anywhere, but then they say, but it is incredibly important that it be taught. And education will collapse if you don't teach it.
It's not happening, and it's good that it is.
Yeah. There is a bit of tension in those. But the third thing they do is they do a bit of a straw man. They say, well, if you don't teach critical race theory, it will mean you won't teach kids about slavery, you won't teach them about the Civil War, you won't teach them about the Civil Rights Movement. That's utter nonsense. Anyone learning the history of America, those are massively important aspects of the history of America. Slavery is the original sin of this nation. It was a grotesque and horrific evil. And yet, if you look at America, tragically, slavery is not what makes America unique. An enormous number of civilizations throughout the world's history have had slavery of one kind or another. What was extraordinary about the United States was not slavery, the evil that it was, but rather emancipation. And so the question was asked, what would the founders have thought about slavery? Well, I can tell you that Jefferson in the Declaration penned the words, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." Now, quickly, one would respond, but Jefferson was a slaveholder, and you're right, and it is an amazing cognitive dissonance that someone participating in an oppressive system like that could nonetheless write words that were a glorious and clarion call to liberty and to equality. And look, where critical race theory gets it wrong is teaching the revisionist notion that America is fundamentally and irredeemably racist, that all of American history is about preserving slavery and preserving racism, that all white people are racist, that everyone is naturally divided based on race. Those are lies. And listen, I am someone who agrees profoundly with many of the heroes of civil rights, people like Frederick Douglass, people like Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., who didn't tear down the principles of the founding. Instead, they powerfully made the case that America wasn't living up to the principles of the founding, that those principles of equality, certainly while slavery existed, Frederick Douglass was incredibly powerful in saying slavery is a grotesque evil and it is counter to the ideas America was founded on. Dr. King, a century later, likewise made a powerful call to the principles this country was founded upon. And so, look, we have not yet achieved a more perfect union, but what the Marxist left does is it ignores any and all of the progress and insists everything is oppressive. And that is fundamentally false. We've got to acknowledge the distance we've traveled, and we can still call for continuing to travel towards greater justice, but that the ideas we were founded upon started us on the path to achieving equal justice for all.
Yep. Now, as usual, we're running extremely late. This is every episode of the show. But before we go, I do want to get to one more question.
Yeah, let's do two more questions.
Two more questions.
This gentleman and whoever's next in line. Go ahead, sir.
Thank you. Hello, Senator Cruz. Thanks for coming out. I really appreciate you being here, making the trip. My name is Jamark Simon. And my question for you, Senator Cruz, is, so according to the Texas Tribune, you refused to certify the Arizona presidential election results. But most Republicans, like Mitch McConnell, have admitted that Joe Biden won. Do you think Joe Biden legitimately won the 2020 election? Why or why not?
Okay, great question. Look, Joe Biden is indisputably the president of the United States today. Now, there are those in the media world that love to go around to Republicans and ask variants of the following question. Do you agree the 2020 election was fair and straight and everything was above board? And the answer to that is no. What is odd about discussions about the 2020 election? Listen, we're in a very polarized time. We're in the most polarized time certainly I've seen in my lifetime. And we're tribalized. Each group, each tribe, the left listens to left-wing media, the right listens to right-wing media, and we have these echo chambers that just reinforce what we believe. So coming out of the 2020 election, the corporate media and the left insisted voter fraud doesn't exist. And if you say voter fraud exists, then you're a tinfoil hat-wearing conspiracy theorist. Now, my view on that is a wildly ahistorical perspective. Voter fraud has been a problem, I believe, as long as we've been having elections, and not just in the United States, as long when the first cavemen gathered together to elect the grand poobah, somebody stuffed the ballot box. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And that has been a persistent challenge. And I've spent over two decades fighting against voter fraud, fighting against, for example, photo ID requirements to vote. When the state of Indiana passed photo ID requirements, I led a coalition of states before the U.S. Supreme Court defending those photo ID requirements. We won 6-3 in a decision authored by Justice John Paul Stevens, one of the most renowned liberals on the court, who explained that protecting the integrity of the election is how you stop people from having their vote stolen. So I think it's important to fight voter fraud. Now, I've talked at considerable length about the 2020 election, and in particular, the objection that I raised on January 6th. And let me give a Cliff Notes version of a discussion that I've talked in far greater length about. In the 2020 election, there were widespread allegations of voter fraud. If you looked at polling at the time, 39% of Americans, nearly half, believed the election had been stolen. That is very disturbing for anyone that wants to see the American people have faith in our democratic system. As we were going to January 6th under legislation called the Electoral Count Act, if a House member and a senator objects to the counting of electoral votes, the two chambers split up into separate chambers, we have 2 hours of debate, and we vote on it. And I spent days and weeks struggling about how to vote. And here was my thinking as I struggled with it. If I vote no, if I vote against an objection, that will be heard and that will be understood by tens of millions of Americans as my saying voter fraud isn't real, it doesn't exist, it's not a real problem. And that is not what I believe. That is emphatically the opposite of what I believe. So I didn't like that option. On the other hand, to simply object to the certification of the election because your guy didn't win, because the candidate you're supporting didn't win, I think that's completely unprincipled and indefensible. So I didn't like that option. And so I'm looking at these two options going, both of these options suck. So I did what lawyers often do, which is try to study history to see if there are any precedents from which we can draw insight. And as I studied history, I focused in particular on the presidential election of 1876. That was an election between Rutherford B. Hayes and Samuel Tilden. Now, in that election, it was a very close election. It was a nasty, divisive election. In that election, there were serious allegations of voter fraud in three different states. And what did Congress do facing those allegations of voter fraud? Congress didn't throw their hands in the air and say, okay, there's nothing we can do, this is terrible, but we're powerless, oh well. That's not what Congress did. What Congress did is they appointed what they called an electoral commission. It consisted of five House members, five senators, and five Supreme Court justices. And that electoral commission conducted an audit of the election results in the three challenged states and examined the actual evidence and made determinations about the allegations of voter fraud. The more I looked at it, the better that precedent seemed to me. And so, as we were heading into January 1st, I was headed back to D.C. Initially, I was just going to announce, this is what I think we should do. And I'd actually typed up a two-page statement. I was on Southwest Airlines flying from Houston back to D.C. and with my laptop typed up a two-page statement. But then as I thought about it, I decided, you know, it would be better not to do this alone, but to try to assemble a coalition together. And so I began visiting with other senators, and in the next 24 hours, a total of 11 senators joined together, and we put out a joint statement in which we said we were going to object to the results of the election in order to call for the appointment of an election commission to conduct an emergency 10-day audit. Now, if that happens on January 6th, it means the audit could be completed before January 20th, so it wouldn't delay the inauguration, and have a determination on the allegations of voter fraud. I continue to believe if Congress had done this, you would have much greater confidence in the election. And as I stood on the Senate floor, and you can watch, I gave a 5-minute speech on the Senate floor advocating for this. I turned to the Democrats and I said, look, all of you insist on TV, there is no voter fraud, it doesn't exist. Well, if you're right, you should welcome the Election Commission, because presumably if the evidence doesn't back up the claims, that's what the commission will determine.
And you know, Senator, there is actually one other historical tidbit here. I know you mentioned the first caveman election where they elected the Grand Poobah. Joe Biden was actually at that election. Did you know that? He was in the caveman Senate. And it seems like a reasonable proposal that you're describing. And it continues to be trotted out in the media as evidence that Republicans don't accept election results. There is another irony to that, which is a poll some months ago showed that a higher percentage of Democrats don't believe the results of the 2016 election than Republicans disbelieve the results of the 2020 election.
It is true. Hillary Clinton went all over the country saying the election was stolen. The election was stolen. Stacey Abrams still says she is the sitting governor of Georgia.
And president of Earth, too, according to Star Trek.
Okay, that's
true.
All right, that was just annoying. All right, let's do one final question. Thank you, sir.
Senator Cruz, thank you for coming. My name is Nicola Ryan Schreiber. And in the year 1971, the U.S. moved off the gold standard. And ever since, the centralization of power around the ability to print money has been the greatest power, essentially, on Earth. And power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And what I have been dismayed to see is that most conservatives, when they claim to say that they want smaller government, but the moment that they have their hand on the money printer, they let money printer go burr. And this is consistent in the last 50 years. And so I'm curious now, with the creation of the hardest money that has ever been created, Bitcoin, how would you feel about moving to a Bitcoin standard?
So look, that is a great question, and thank you for that question. Let me take a couple of pieces of it. There's no doubt that when the United States moved off the gold standard, it facilitated a massive inflation of our currency. It made it easier for government to print money. And for politicians, look, It's actually easy to reach a bipartisan deal in Washington. The way you do it is you sit down with everyone in the room and we say, we'll spend $1 billion for you, billion for you, billion for you, billion for you, you get to $1 trillion and you're done. And on that deal, you get all the Democrats and you get half to two-thirds of the Republicans. And in the Senate, there are consistently about 20 of us who object to excessive spending, who try to fight for spending restraint, but sadly, you often see the vote about 80 to 20. The massive spending in Washington is what is fueling the inflation that is hurting the American people so profoundly right now. And it is one of the things that is fueling the move to Bitcoin. And as you may know, I am a huge proponent of Bitcoin. I'm a huge proponent of cryptocurrency. I think it is an incredibly important innovation. I think one of the reasons, I personally am an investor in Bitcoin. One of the reasons that you are seeing people move to Bitcoin is exactly what you said, as a hedge to inflation. That Bitcoin, by design, cannot go over 21 million Bitcoin. It's a finite sum, and at the end of the day, a currency is a means of exchange and a way of setting value of one item vis-a-vis another item. And, you know, one of the ways to understand inflation is if an apple is $1 and a banana is $2, and you double the number of dollars on planet Earth, then roughly speaking, you would expect the apple to be $2 and the banana to be $4. Now, the math doesn't work out exactly the same, but that's the principle, is that currency gives the relative values of one good or service vis-a-vis another. When you have politicians devaluing everyone's goods and services, they look for other ways to store value. It's why people in times of inflation are drawn to gold or drawn to silver or drawn to real estate or commodities, other hard assets, as it hedges to inflation. So I am a big proponent of Bitcoin. I think the single greatest threat to Bitcoin and crypto is Washington politicians screwing it up, and it is a very real threat. You asked if I would support our going to it as legal tender. Look, I'm not looking for the government to make the choice to supplant the dollar. I know there are a lot in the Bitcoin community that believe it will inevitably go that way, and if it does, I'm fine with that too. But I don't think you should have a government mandate to make it so, but I think it is important. I think the Bitcoin community and the crypto community writ large is an incredibly blossoming industry. China just shut it down. Texas is becoming ground zero for Bitcoin and crypto. I want to welcome everyone to Texas. And I actually think the Bitcoin world is at a fork in the road an awful lot like big tech was about 15 years ago. Where big tech in Silicon Valley, it could have gone one road to being a libertarian utopia, leave me alone, let us be free and innovate, or it could have gone the road it chose, which is a woke, scolding, censoring, socialist mob. And unfortunately, it chose the latter. My hope is that Bitcoin and crypto chooses the former. And so I think we ought to be looking for ways to encourage innovation and development in Bitcoin and crypto more broadly.
Now, I want to thank you. That was an excellent question. I want to thank everyone out there who had questions. I want to thank our Verdict Plus community. I want to thank Carol Brown and the Irving Brown Lecture Series. I want to thank the William F. Buckley Jr. Program at Yale. I want to thank Young America's Foundation. I want to thank our friend Liz Wheeler, host of The Liz Wheeler Show, and Cloakroom over at Verdict Plus. Senator, I always want to thank you. And I want to thank everyone who has tuned in here in the room. I want to thank everyone who's tuned in on YouTube. This has been a wonderful time with all of you at Yale. Thank you so much. I'm Michael Knowles. This is Verdict with Ted Cruz.